Well, the time is upon us to get started this morning. If you will start heading in and over to your seats, and be sure to grab a communion cup in the back if you haven't already done that. As we get ready for worship and our time together this morning. And then as you get seated, if you don't mind grabbing one of your communication cards on the back of the pew in front of you and fill that out, and it will be picked up towards the end of our time together. Well, good morning, church. It is a good morning. It is a good day to be together. And we are so pleased that you have chosen to be here with us this morning, as well as those of you who are joining us online. We just appreciate your presence and just the opportunity for us together to worship and to honor God with those who are here this morning. You know, for so many, this time of year, this week marks a highlight and just some heightened sense of anticipation with what is to come. Just being over a week away from Christmas. You've got some who have already finished their semester at school. You've got some who are looking forward to it ending here pretty soon. You've got many who gladly look forward and await just a couple days off of work. And you've got some who are excited about the opportunity to spend times with family, with friends. And then there's the possibility of that visit from Santa and just the hopefulness and the thrill of opening the presents under the tree and just that time of celebration together. You know, this is a time of year that is full of hope, a time of year that is full of peace, it's full of joy. And as we get to experience love in just some beautiful ways. And this also marks the final week of Advent for those who have been going through that, through this season, embracing and honoring just this movement of our Lord as He came from heaven to earth. This gift to each of us from our Heavenly Father, this offering of blessing, and all pointed to this great moment when an ultimate sacrifice was made for each and every one of us. And then even our anticipation, our excitement, our desire for the opportunity to see Him again one day and what that means for each and every one of us. That hope of heaven that we have, and the beauty of how it comes together. And there's this full circle for what He wanted to engage with us, what He wanted to provide for us, what He wanted to experience with us, and what we get to experience with Him. And as we come this morning, that is just a small part of what we are here to celebrate, what we are here to honor, what we are here to do with our Lord, to share with Him, to offer to Him, and allow Him to also encourage and bless us. And so we thank You again for being here this morning, and we appreciate Your presence to be able to come together as a body to worship, to share our encouragement with each other, to praise our Heavenly Father, and to sing songs of glory to Him. So let us stand as we enter into this time of worship.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With the angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Mild He lays His glory by, born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. veiled in flesh, the Godhead seep. Hail the incarnate deity. Pleased as man with men to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
The chorus to this next song is Gloria in Excelsis Deo. And we don't sing Latin a lot. And just so that we know the praises we're singing to our God, it means glory to God in the highest.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo, gloria in excelsis Deo. Shepherds, why this jubilee? Why your joyous strains prolong? What the gladsome tidings be which inspire your heavenly song? Gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Come to Bethlehem and see Christ, whose birth the angels sing. Come adore on bended knee Christ the Lord, the newborn King. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold, the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Please be seated.
So we gather here every week. And this never gets old, does it? Being here with our Christian brothers and sisters, being here with this family. And I always look forward to being here on Sunday and seeing everybody and knowing how much that y'all all mean to me and my family and how much that I know we all mean to each other. There are times when people do things that we would call a hero because they sacrifice their life to save someone else. And that's the ultimate sacrifice, but maybe it saved one person or maybe a family or something of that nature. But we celebrate a death here today or an action here today that has the potential to save the whole world. When Christ gave his life and he made that sacrifice, and look at it's just hard to fathom what that means to the world and to each and every one of us, that a sacrifice of that nature could give us all eternal life. And when we celebrate his death, and we do celebrate the death, because without that death, there wouldn't be that possibility of eternal life. And we're just so thankful that he was willing to hang upon that cross for our sins. Would you bow with me at this time? Our Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for this church, this group of people here, Father, and what they mean to me and my family, and once again, like I said, what we all mean to each other, how we support each other, and we all come together. And Father, we're so mindful of the sacrifice that you made when you gave your son to hang on that cross. And Father, we're mindful of his suffering and the torture and the bloodshed. And although he had committed no sin, he was perfect. He was willing to make that sacrifice, the ultimate sacrifice, the sacrifice that ended all other sacrifices. There was no need for any more after that. And Christ and Father, we're just so thankful that you are willing to sacrifice him for our behalf. Father, we ask now with that in mind that you be with us as we take of this cup and of this bread that represents his body and blood. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus. Like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus. Like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Let's stand as we sing the song. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching, o'er silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens, there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds feared and trembled when low above the earth rang out the angel chorus that hailed our Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Down in a lowly manger, our humble Christ was born. And God sent us salvation that blessed Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Please be seated.
Bow with me as we pray, please. Lord, we come to you with a grieving heart this morning as we lost one of our friends, a loved one, a member of this church, Mr. Rick Binkley. Please be with his family as they try to understand his death. Let us all also know and rejoice that he is with you in the kingdom of heaven and that we will get to see Rick again one day. Lord, we also had a tragic tornado and a round of storms came through last weekend. Please be with those families that lost friends and loved ones, property, those that are injured. Please be with them and help them to understand everything that just happened. we all don't understand, but we understand that your plan is a greater plan. And be with them, please, during this dark time. Lord, also be with the missionaries around the world, especially in Haiti, with Second Mile Haiti, as they are bringing your word to those people down there who are really, really need to have God in their heart. Please be with those missionaries. They're in a dangerous, dangerous area, but they are bringing the word of God to those people. And one day they will know and understand you and your love and know that we'll not be alone. Lord, please be with our doctors, our police, our fire, our EMTs, all of our first responders as they strive every day of their lives to keep us safe and healthy and enjoy our life. And please be with them because they put their lives on the line every day that they are awake. Lord, please be with the people during this time of year, Christmas especially, going through dark times. We don't know what's going on with them, but you do, Lord. Please be with those people. Let them know that that light at the end of that tunnel is you and that they will know peace. Please be with them and protect them. Go with us now as we have a scripture reading and listen to Martin bring us our lesson today. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen.
The scripture this morning is from Luke 2, verses 8 through 20. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glorify to God in the highest heaven and on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying God, praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
There are a large number of areas in my life that I don't have personal experience about. And so as a result of that, I have to depend upon others. And so that means, for an example, that I've got to talk to someone, I've got to read a book or instruction manual, or more likely today I will have a podcast that I go to that I'll follow, or I'll do a search on YouTube and somebody will lay it out step by step for a complete idiot, and that usually defines about where I am on most of those projects. If you've been following Rachel or I on Facebook or social media, you know that about 5 months ago, we undertook a project to convert our deck into a four-season room. And I'm way out over my head, okay? I mean, this is something I've never done before, and it shows. I mean, I can really tell. And so we've been doing this in stages along the line and kind of learning or trying to learn as we go along. And again, many of the steps that are part of that are way outside my experience set. Just as an example, I called or talked to David Boyd, and he came over, and he was talking to me about the electrical, because I don't do electric, okay? I don't touch wires. Yeah, I just don't touch wires. And it was great because he could tell me what I needed to do and what should be done, and he had a guy that he knew who he could get over there really quick and could get that taken care of. And that was wonderful because they zipped through it. And really, that's just one example that I could give you a whole lot of others that that I just don't know. I'm just not experienced about. And I reference that because we're going to talk about sheep and shepherds today. And I don't know anything about sheep and shepherds. I've never tended sheep. I've never herded sheep. I've never cared for sheep. I have pet sheep a time or two at a petting zoo. That is the full extent of what I know about sheep. Except for the fact that the Bible talks a lot about sheep and talks a lot about shepherds, and I have had to study and kind of go into the background of what it is to be a shepherd and to care for sheep. As you can tell from the songs that we have sung and from the reading this morning, we're going to be talking about shepherds. And I'll encourage you to be turning your Bibles over to Luke chapter 2, your devices if you want to follow along, because that's where we're going to be focused in our lesson for this morning. I'd like to start, though, with a little bit of a side bar, maybe a little bit of reminder. It was December 4 years ago that we first started hearing some rumors of an unusual disease over in China. And we didn't think a whole lot about it because, first of all, it was in a city that none of us knew how to pronounce, something called Wuhan. And, I mean, that sounds like it's on the other side of the world. And there were like 40 confirmed cases, and it was very contagious and possibly deadly. But, again, it's over in China. Don't worry about it. It's not going to be a big deal. Until the end of the month when the cases had risen to 180, and of course by the middle of January it was 1,700, and those were the confirmed cases, not including those that were slipping between the cracks. And as a result of that, we learned a new vocabulary, didn't we? We started off calling it coronavirus, but then folks started associating it with that Mexican beer. And so the next thing you knew, we changed it to COVID-19. And you remember there were all kinds of these new behaviors that we had never, ever done before. Does this bring back any memories? And then after a little bit of time, we got snazzy because, first of all, you couldn't find those anymore. Remember all the shortages of masks? And so we started making some of our own. And I ought to play Rocky Top as I get this one out. And it became part of our new experience, right? You would go to the grocery store and there wasn't any toilet paper. You'd go to the grocery store, you couldn't buy tissue. You couldn't buy Clorox. You couldn't. And you realize, don't you, that there's a generation of kids that, you know, 20, 30 years from now are not going to understand this at all. So we had these new behaviors and new words and phrases, social distancing. Who had heard of that? Who imagined that before? And then this whole definition that came out of essential workers. Now, we knew that that was Don and the police officers. You know, we knew that that was nurses and hospital people, okay? But we discovered a whole nother category of essential workers, truck drivers and the cashiers and stock people down at Kroger and Walmart. And that whole notion that those folks were essential really kind of shifted and changed our perspective, did it not? Well, I want you to understand that in the first century, shepherds were essential workers. They were essential workers. And the reason for that was, frankly, very, very simple, okay? And that is that there were sacrifices that had to be offered in the morning and in the afternoon in the temple in Jerusalem each and every single day. And if it was a Sabbath, there was a need for additional lambs to be sacrificed. And then if it happened to be a feast day like Passover or Pentecost, there was a requirement for 7 extra male lambs. And so you could not have the temple worship move forward if you didn't have these individuals? It was necessary, it was essential that those lambs be kept nearby. And yet, and this is one of the things that my research kind of pointed out for me, is that despite their essential nature and the need for them to be there, they were not highly regarded. They weren't viewed as folks who were essential. Instead, it was quite the opposite for most of them. Shepherds, by the nature of their work, were generally ceremonially unclean. They weren't allowed to participate in the worship at the temple that they were performing such an essential duty for, because they were around sheep, and sheep are around manure, and they get cuts and abrasions, and they bleed, and all of that means that the people who are providing for everybody else to be made right with God under that particular system, instead what we find is that those individuals are considered outsiders. Those individuals are not part of the system. And that background helps us, I think, understand much better the visit of the angels in Luke chapter 2. Because, frankly, the announcement to this group of people was remarkable. I mean, this message of the birth of the Messiah going out to this group, and not the priests, not the politicians, not the leaders, the Sadducees and others, etc., around the temple, but into a field between Jerusalem and Bethlehem to shepherds. And it foreshadows an emphasis that will be part of the ministry of Jesus. Luke has a rather interesting way of organizing his gospel. As he does so, he pulls some of the teachings and situations that Jesus is in, and he brings a particular event and puts it very near the front. And that is where Jesus is in Nazareth, and he is teaching in the synagogue there. And as Luke describes that to us, it becomes an incredibly important event. Jesus sits down, and they bring to him the scroll of Isaiah. Now, Isaiah has 66 chapters, and an individual would have set that scroll down, and it would always have been rolled to chapter 1. And so Jesus opens that scroll, and he's going to go to the text that he wants to read. And so he has to carefully roll that scroll over. Chapter 1. Chapter 2. Chapter 3. You'll be thankful that I don't go all the way to where Jesus does, chapter 61. Jesus goes to chapter 61 very carefully, very intentionally, and reads the following text. It is found in Luke's gospel in chapter 4, verses 18 and 19. The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's good favor. I want you to understand that the shepherds are representatives of this key emphasis and work of Jesus. Shepherding was not a pathway to riches. It was hard, dirty, difficult work with little time off and no fringe benefits. And throughout Luke's telling of the gospel, in what he says about the good news, he emphasizes the work of Jesus toward the lowly, toward the poor, toward the outsiders, and to those who are the outcasts. I think that is a very important message to us today. When Paul wants to give a message to the deeply divided church at Corinth, in chapter 1, verses 26 through 29, he begins with a reminder of their background, and he said, "Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are so that no one may boast before him." Now, there were likely some pretty well-to-do upper-class folks that were represented within the church at Corinth, but clearly from this statement, the overwhelming majority of folks who were part of those churches there in that great city were from the lower and working classes. And that, critically important, is God's observation as well. I don't think a whole lot has changed in the centuries since. There are, with few exceptions, few blue bloods, few among the aristocrats, few among the privileged nobles of wealth who are really devoted followers of God. I mean, if we think about it just in terms of percentages, there are fewer devoted Christians along Belmead Boulevard than there are along Jefferson Street. Less disciples in the Hamptons than in Antioch or in Murfreesboro. And frankly, that's pretty good news for most all of us, because in Luke chapter 2, and even by corollary in our day, God comes to those who receive him. God comes to those who answer his call. We rejoice that coming to Christ is not about who you are descended from. It's not about who your parents were or grandparents. It's not about any of that. Instead, what we find, and we'll pick up another text. This one would have taken Jesus a little bit longer. It's in Isaiah chapter 66. "These are the ones I look on with favor, those who are humble and contrite in spirit and who tremble at my word." And that is who we need to be. It also says something about who, as we think about sharing this good news with those around us, where we need to be aiming and focusing our attention. We need to be thinking about those who are most likely to receive the good news. Look, I would tell you, it would be great to have some among the Frists or the Ingrams come and be part of our congregation here at Riverwood. But the teaching of Scripture is that that is not as likely. Instead, Scripture, and for that matter, the history of Christianity, points to the fact that the shepherds of our day, however we might identify that, they're the ones who are most likely to be receptive to the gospel. Jesus was sent to this earth to pay the price for sins, the sins for everyone. But in the 2,000 years since that sacrifice, in the time that that has happened, those who are not as blessed by the world's things, by power and connections, those are the ones who have regarded him most highly. But whether we are rich or poor, whether we are intelligent or struggling, we must receive him. And that's the closing part of my thoughts for this morning. And it takes us back to our text in Luke chapter 2, starting in verse 15. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." There is no delay. There is no debate, no discussion, just obedience. When called by God, they answer. And I think their response serves as a wonderful example for each and every single one of us. Let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you so much that you chose to bring the message of your Son, his coming as the Messiah, the one who would provide forgiveness of sins, that you brought that to lowly shepherds, lowly outcasts of our world, like so many of us. And we thank you, Father, that your love and forgiveness and attention is often focused upon those in our culture and society. And we pray, Father, that you would make us more cognizant of that, that you would help us to see those around us who find themselves in those circumstances. Help us, Father, to share your good news of salvation with any and all. But, Father, help us to realize your particular interest in those like the shepherds. We pray that you would care for us as we are members of your flock. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child. Holy infant, so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace. Silent night, holy night, shepherds quake at the sight, glory stream from heaven afar, heavenly hosts sing alleluia. Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born. Silent night, holy night, Son of God, love's pure light, radiant beams from thy holy face. With the dawn of redeeming grace, Jesus us, Lord, at thy birth. Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. Silent night, holy night, wondrous star, lend thy light with the angels, let us sing. Alleluia to our King. Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born.
Please be seated.
What a wonderful morning it is for us to be together and to worship such an amazing God and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. What a blessing it is this morning to be together. I thank you for your presence. I truly thank you for that. At this time, if you have filled out one of your communications cards, our kids will go on and pick those up right now. You know, just this morning, I was thinking about it. Rick always, whenever he was preaching at 7:15, he would leave his house. He would go to MAPCO and get his Diet Pepsi. And then in his car, he would practice his sermons. But what makes me laugh about it is that he would practice his sermons and make sure he held up a phone or something that looked like a phone so that people driving beside him wouldn't think he was crazy. You know, truly this week we lost one of the most influential men in this congregation's history. And so we want to be praying for the Binkley family. Just want to give you just the information on his funeral. The visitation will be Tuesday, December 19th. That will be at Spring Hill. Visitation will be from 9:30 to 11:30. The funeral services will be at 11:30. And then following that, there will be the burial at Spring Hill as well. So I hope you have the opportunity to come Tuesday to be with the family for that. 9:30 to 11:30, and then 11:30 is the funeral. But be praying for Debbie and for Emily and for Daniel and just all of their family. In his passing. And then also on our prayer list, continue to be lifting up Tammy Matthews. She had open heart surgery on December 14th. Sorry, losing my dates. On Thursday, December 14th. And she had a rough last couple days, but yesterday was a really good day. So the hopes are that she'll be able to go home tomorrow or Tuesday. So be praying for Rick and for Tammy and their family as well. I just want to give you also an update on December 24th and the 31st, Christmas Eve and New Year's Eve. We will only have morning worship, no Bible classes those days, but we invite you to be here for that. If you are traveling, be safe at traveling as well. And then this week, this Thursday, we are handing out all of the presents for our East End families that we've collected. And so if you're interested in being there at East End to help with that, please let me know. Tentatively, the time is, I believe, from 10 to noon, but that could change a little bit. But that will be up at the school. And it's a great day just to share and handing out the presents. As I just want to let you guys know, you have generously gifted presents for 59 kids, which is 21 families. It's just going to be a tremendous gift to them. So be praying for that, just that it's more than just presence being given, but truly that the love of Christ is seen in that. So be praying for that. I think that is all my information I've got for you this morning. I thank you for being here.
Riverwood is so very, very blessed. We serve a God, a creator, that has watched over this congregation for over 70 years. We serve a God who is holy, who is mighty, who continues to provide. And we have countless blessings. The blessing of Christ that we have sung about and learned about and worshiped and praised this morning. The blessing of creation, the blessing of God's word, the blessing of this congregation and each person that's a part of it. Our staff, our members, we are blessed beyond belief. We have seen a storm in the past week that, as far as we know, no one in our church family had any serious damage or loss from. God continually watches over us. We have a special announcement this morning, and as we talk about this, Corey's going to lead us in a prayer of praise and thanksgiving.
Let's bow. Lord, we're so blessed. We're so blessed that 70 years ago, 70 plus years ago, you saw fit to put this church here, that our ancestors before us had that commitment and forethought to, and really faith, to stand up this church, to be a light in this community, to further your kingdom, and to bring, to share your word with others. Lord, this morning as we give praise, and we're so excited about this upcoming announcement, Lord, we give praise to you. I give praise for the staff that we have here by name, but Martin. We're so thankful for Martin and his pulpit messages, and for Matt and for Greg and for Linda and Janice, who so just eagerly helped out this year. Lord, we're thankful for another behind-the-scenes employee that works with us, with Miss Diane, who keeps our building clean, and her crew that does that. Pray that you'll watch over her and her family this holiday season, and we're thankful for her. Lord, I'm thankful for these members, the commitment that we have, exemplified by what Greg just announced, with our commitment to serve the East End community and their needs, to help fill those needs, the inner city needs, to lift each other up during times of struggle, during times of loss. We're thankful for that, and it's all through you that we know we have the ability and the strength to do that. Lord, as we look into this holiday season, help us to always keep the focus on you, that we always think about Christ's birth is why we're celebrating Christmas. We know that this time can be thought about in a lot of different ways, but help us to keep you at the center of everything that we do. Lord, I pray special, I'm just so excited about this special announcement. I pray that you'll help the congregation to be excited about that as well as we are as the shepherds. And Lord, we're thankful for this time, this morning, that we're allowed to come here and worship you, sing praises, read scripture, and to always give you all the glory. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
So we are warming by fires we didn't build. Years ago, our chorus director at school kind of used that phrase to talk about those that Corey has just prayed for that have gone before us. Whether we are members, teachers, deacons, ministers, shepherds, whatever our role in this church family, there are those that have gone before us that have done incredible things so that we can be here now with the blessings that we have now. Many of those people have passed. Greg just mentioned one. Rick Binkley served us for over 40 years. Probably did almost every role in this congregation at some point. Maybe didn't keep the nursery, which is probably a good thing. But so many have passed. There are many that are planting seeds throughout the world that have come from this church family. One of the positions that has been a constant in this congregation as long as I've known is the church secretary. Rachel served in that position for close to 20 years. Cindy Graham filled that role before her for many years, and there were others that served before Cindy. Rachel was able to take that role, that position, and turn it into more than a secretarial position. Even though we never called Rachel a minister, Rachel, if you ever want us to do that, let us know. Even though we never called Rachel a minister, she turned that position into a ministry. And most of us in this room have experienced the blessing of that. Since Rachel let us know that she would be retiring, we've been looking for the right person to fill this position. And as Corey prayed about Linda and Janice, they've helped to fill some things in that position. Matt and Greg have taken on extra duties and have worked many hours leading up to this point. Matt, Greg, we appreciate you guys so much for all that you've done, for all that you continue to do. Linda nor Janice were interested in taking the role full time. We appreciate all that they have done. Thank you so much, ladies, in helping us with this to keep things going in the church office as we've waited on God to answer our prayers for this position. And each of them continue to be an amazing blessing to our church family. Please, when you get a chance, take a moment to thank those folks. We also want to thank you for your prayers, your patience, as we've sought to fill this position. And as we've looked at this position, as we've discussed it among the shepherds and the staff, we want it to continue to be a ministry, and we want it to expand into even more of a ministry. And we want the title of that position to reflect that role. So today we are very pleased and we are very blessed to announce that God has answered our prayers for a communications minister. So what does it mean to use that title instead of secretary or administrative assistant or something else? Well, a minister is defined as a servant or a messenger. And as children of God, we are all ministers. We all serve. We all have a message to share, and that's been a part of our lessons and our theme for the past several months. But even though we're all ministers, that doesn't mean that we all will spend time in the pulpit. It doesn't mean that we all will take a leadership role in worship. It means that we minister. It means that we're all going to serve, we're going to teach, we're going to work with others. We're going to share the message of Christ in various ways. We're going to try to meet the needs of those that are around us. And even though this position is going to be titled as a minister, it's not going to be a position that leads in public worship. So having said all that, we are very excited and very blessed to announce that Brittany Denton will be serving as our new communications minister. Yes, you can applaud. And because of that, Brittany, Jackson, Lucas, did I get the name right? Please tell me I got the name right. Goodness gracious, come on down or come on up, whichever way you want to view it. We have been so blessed. Lucas can come on his own if he wants to. We have been so blessed to have this family as part of our church family all the way up here. As part of our church family. Brittany served as our youth intern for 2018, 2019, and 2020, and our kids quickly grew to love her, and so did the rest of the congregation. And thankfully, there's one person in this congregation that is more at peace than anybody else right now, right? Man, so cool. Thankfully, after Brittany graduated from Harding, she began attending Riverwood and became a part of our church family. And then somewhere along the way, somebody else started showing up. Yeah, that'd be you, Jackson, for which we are also thankful. And Jackson has endeared himself to everyone here. And Jackson, we are so grateful for you that you're part of our family. And now we are blessed with Lucas. There was a wedding somewhere in between, just to... Okay. You know, just wanted to make sure everybody understood that. In addition, Brittany's going to start on January 2nd. She's going to be working 4 days a week, mostly Monday through Thursday, but there's going to be some variance to that occasionally. In addition to office and communication duties, she and Jackson are also going to be working with our college students and our young adults. And we ask for your prayers for Brittany, for Jackson, for Lucas, as she enters this new role. We also ask you for continued prayers for our church family. that God will lead and that God will be glorified in all that we do. Ben's going to lead us in a special prayer.
Well, I can at least speak for the Colliers and say, Brittany, pretty much ever since we met you, we kind of fell in love with you. Our girls just adore you, and Catherine and I hold you, obviously, in very high regard as a dear friend of ours, and we just took Jackson as a package deal. But no, we love you, brother. I enjoy spending time with you. I enjoy just kind of all that you're into, your passion, and just what you guys mean to us. And at this point, we just kind of want to say a prayer blessing over you guys, not just from a job, not just from a role, but what you guys mean to us, what you mean to Riverwood, what you mean to the kingdom. I know you are highly favored and loved by God and certainly loved by all of us. So let's pray a prayer of blessing over you guys, and then we'll head on to our classes. Let's pray. Father God, we praise your holy name. We're so thankful and so blessed to be here today, to have this opportunity just to worship you, to sing praises to your name, to learn more about your holy word, to celebrate, to commemorate, to remember, and even though our hearts are somewhat burdened right now, Father, with our recent loss and other losses and just other turmoil, Father, we celebrate, we praise, we're so thankful that we get to make this announcement, we get to make this this known that we have such a wonderful and great resource to kind of bring to the fold here. We're so thankful for Brittany, for Jackson, for Lucas, for their family, for what they mean to us. We pray that we can mean that much to them, that we can bless them each and every day, and just so thankful that they choose to serve you, Father, they choose to follow you, and they choose to show your glory in their lives and what they do and what they mean to other people. Father, we pray a prayer blessing right now over them, over their family, just over their walk, Father, what they choose to do each and every day. We pray a special prayer over Brittany as she takes on this role, this position, this opportunity to be a communications minister, to share your glory with everyone she encounters each and every day. Sure, to handle the administrative duties, but also to share so many wonderful things that are going on in the Riverwood congregation, the things that you bless, the things that you open up and give opportunity to. We pray that she takes on this role with fervor, that she is able to continue it and carry forward such a wonderful tradition and opportunity that's been created by so many wonderful people before her. Thank you for your powerful and mighty blessings that you continue to rain down upon us, and we pray that as we see this position progress, that more and more are just brought to your light, Father. Be with us today. Watch over us. Keep us safe. Thank you for these wonderful blessings. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Y'all go to class.
He's good.
He always does.
Good job, buddy.